Oh, well, hello there. Welcome back. Okay, so let's talk about marriage. There's a couple of different ways in which we usually see marriages take place. We have companionate marriages, which are marriages based on love, right? This is the common model within the United States. And then you have arranged marriages, and these are marriages that are created between two different family groups, right? And we should all pretty much know that there's a big difference between the twos. Arranged marriages, you don't typically have a lot of say who that person that you're going to be married to is, right? And that's important to kind of remember. Is that marriage that's taking place? Yeah, you don't get to choose. Your parents get to choose. Your grandparents get to choose. Your aunts and uncles get to choose, and they go through this rigorous process of finding that other family and that other person that will match. And it's an interesting way of looking at marriages. And we certainly within our own culture, within Western cultures, usually frown upon arranged marriages, because we have really hyper focused on concepts of like love and choosing our mate. Interestingly enough, if we look at the statistics, arranged marriages are more successful than companionate marriages based on love. And a lot of that actually has to do on what the marriage is actually for. Right, we have romanticized marriage as finding our perfect mate and then, raising a family and doing all that. And it isn't always necessarily about finding the right person to share resources with or whose family is going to be able to contribute to your development. It's about alliance making oftentimes when it comes to arranged marriages. And usually the folks that have the best experience, the elder folks within that family, are typically better at finding the better matches. At least statistically speaking, we can look at our own sort of ideas on marriage, and half of our marriages end in divorce. And there's a lot of reasons for that. We'll get into that later. Right, so these are the two main ways that we look at marriages within the majority of cultures out there. So Western culture really focuses on sort of companionate marriages, and this has sort of been pushed dramatically through that hegemonic American belief system of finding that perfect love, that relationship. We deal with it in our movies, in our music, and all this stuff, and looking for concepts of like independence, right? And it really pushes out there this idea of what is the most appropriate. And we oftentimes think about that in that sort of biased cultural way, right? That you should have the choice to make whatever it is, whatever decisions you want. But we also know, right, that the folks that are getting married, especially at an early age, don't always make the best decision, right? Because you don't have the experience, you don't have the knowledge, and the person that you fall in love with might be a complete disaster, right? That you had no idea about because you. Parents and grandparents didn't do all the investigative work for you. So, it's a different way of going about doing it. This also changes how even like family structures are organized, right? A lot of times that companionate marriage also means independence from the greater family, right? So it allows you to move out and establish your own home. but it can, in some cases, disconnect you from those social networks that arranged marriages can oftentimes sort of encourage to deal with. Then we've got different types of marriages. We have monogamy, right? Which is being married to one other person, typically of the opposite sex, right? And we'll distinguish the difference. There is a difference between sex and gender, right? But a typical monogamy is done through different sexes. Serial monogamy, this is where you get married and then you might get a divorce, or you might be widowed and then you get married again, and you have multiple marriages. You have polygyny, when you have one man that has multiple wives. You have polyandry, which is when one woman has one or more, or two or more husbands. There aren't that many instances of polyandry, but it certainly can happen and does. And then you have homosexual marriage, right? Which is same-sex marriages. And we start getting into much more complicated areas when we start including LGBTQ into these conversations, because we're creating new spaces for concepts of marriage, for people to find their identity when it comes to, again, practicing love and marriage, and then looking at the rights and responsibilities for those people that, getting married usually comes with some pretty decent tax breaks, right? So, or access to medical care or medical responsibility. And so we have to look at not only how that culture deals with these different concepts, but how they deal with, say, even just like as much as 10, 15 years ago, when it came to gay or lesbian marriage, that some hospitals wouldn't recognize your spouse as someone that has actual control over your body, right? Say you got married to this person, but this hospital says state law says that you can't make a say about whether this person goes on life support or comes off of life support, right? Can't make those decisions, right? Those medical decisions, even though you're a spouse, and that is one of those things that comes with marriage, is being able to make those decisions for your significant other. Laws, right? Can change and determine those things, and that's why it's important that we talk about those kinds of things. Who has those rights and responsibilities? Where are they coming from? What are the laws supporting them? In nearly every culture, there is like an incest taboo, in which marrying a brother or sister or having children with a parent or a grandparent is usually frowned upon, right? And that's because genetically it's not a good idea. Cousins are still sort of one of those things. I think in 19 states it's still legal to be able to marry your first cousin. But in the rest of the states, it's, as far as I know, illegal to do that. Something to be said there. So how people reproduce, right? Most people reproduce and find someone outside of the family. And we've seen what happens when reproduction is kept within the family, and you usually end up having a lot of genetic issues. But it usually takes a number of generations for those issues to come about, right? It's not just like, the brother and sister end up having a kid and they have a third eyeball. That doesn't usually happen. It usually happens like two or three generations later on when you start seeing those really significant genetic and health issues So, you know, that's something that needs to be considered. I don't know. That's just, it's kind of a weird subject. But yeah, that most cultures have this taboo, and it helps to not only keep sort of like those genetic lanes cleared, but it also helps to create sort of social alliances with other communities, right? And now, typically, this can be sort of an issue, right? So most cultures practice what we call exogamy, right? And this is the practice of marrying outside of your family or clan. It helps to eliminate that incest taboo, but again, it helps to create alliances. Some practice endogamy. And the best example that I can kind of explain that is like sort of like the royal families of Europe, right? If we go back over the last 500, 600 years and we look at the royal families of, you know, Germany and Spain and England and Italy and all of those, and how they would be marrying each other, right? Send this princess over here and that prince over there. And all of a sudden, that genetic pool started shrinking, right? If all you're doing is marrying within these certain families to gain sort of that relationship and that power, we end up starting to see that genetic soup becoming a little iffy. And you start seeing social behaviors becoming a little bit more erratic. Also, behaviors with within the family, it gets way more complicated and usually not good, right? But that's the practice of endogamy, and a lot of times it's to maintain that wealth, right? Not sharing the wealth, not sharing the power that those people end up having. And again, it's not a common practice. So and that's a good thing. Okay. We as Americans oftentimes practice kindred exogamy. What this means is that we will oftentimes focus on people of our own like race when we consider race, ethnicity, cultural ideology, socioeconomic background, all of those things usually get taken into consideration when you're looking for that spouse. And so you end up seeing a lot of marriages, not a lot of interracial marriages, not a lot of intereconomic relationships. And part of it is that shared experience, right? Having that shared experience. This person understands me better. And that's usually one of the main explanations for doing that. We also are coming out of a legacy in which it was illegal, right, to have interracial marriages, right? We go back 60 years and it was illegal to marry someone outside of your race. Now, here's the thing about that, right? We made it legal to do that through civil rights, but there was still social pressure not to, right? Just because it was made legal doesn't mean that people are just going to automatically start going out having interracial relationships. It had been taught for so long that it was bad that people weren't going to immediately start doing it. So there was this legacy that helps us to understand that these practices are still going on, even though 60 years later, you know, we've sort of gotten past that. And there are still complications, right? Families still have hang-ups. So, you know, this idea things like interracial marriage. This is still something that we as a culture are coming to grips with, right? Younger generations certainly don't have the same sort of issues. But if we go to, you know, the like early Gen Xers and baby boomers, there are still hangups about that kind of stuff because they were taught that this was a right way of doing things or a wrong way of doing things, even though, right, it might have been legal to do so. So there can be that cultural legacy that lasts and can have that sort of influence. Okay, so I want you guys to think about kinship for a second. We'll do a quick exercise. Where do we find kinship? Outside of the family, I should say. And I think the thing that needs to be said is that kinship is not just something that, we can say we find in a group. Oh, I go to the library and I join a reading group. You join a group. You do not have kinship with them, unless that library group you became basically family. You guys shared meals and resources and helped each other out. Because kinship isn't just like being friends with someone. It is treating them like family, giving them access to your resources. They give you access to their resources. And you have that sort of familiar thing. So an example in which you might find kinship through shared experience would be places like, say, the military, right? You might meet people there that you end up calling brother or sister, right? That you would fight or die for, and that is a place through shared experience, shared trauma, right? That you can actually gain that kinship. It doesn't always happen, but it certainly can happen there. You can find some kinship in other organizations, so say like religious institutions, churches. You can find some kinship there, again, because working with people, spending your entire lives creating those connections, those relationships, are also that. You can have groups of friends that can become so close that they are considered to be family, and that is certainly something that I experience as well. I have a number of friends who I consider to be family, right? And I treat their kids like they're my nieces and nephews, right? Even though biologically they're not, when it comes to cultural practices, I do, right? So those are some things that we can look at as far as like kinship. Where else would you find kinships? Take a couple moments to think about that. And then there's social clans. These are groups of people that share common practices, common ideologies, maybe not the same sort of in-depthness as kinship, but you associate with. And, I would throw in stuff like gaming, right? You might have a group of gamers that come together and engage in that kind of activity, right? Not necessarily the same in-depthness as you might find with brother and sister, but an activity in which a number of you come together, share those experiences, and then they become more important to you than people outside of that clan group. Okay, take a moment, think about it. We'll move on. Okay, so kinship outside of marriage and biology, we kind of talked about this. We oftentimes see kinship through the process of the biology, having kids, and that also entails marriage, right? You marry into a family, and then they become kinship, right? Your mother-in-law and father-in-law might treat you as one of their kids, and you might treat them as as a parent. So you create those relationships, and then you have your chosen family, right? And these are the people that you bring in, and they have that same sort of influence and can talk to you about those, you know, important things without worrying about social boundaries, right? Then we come to the subject of how families have changed, right? And this is kind of an interesting idea. So early in American history, a lot of our families were sort of centrally located, right? You move somewhere with your family, and it was kind of a big deal if you moved away, right? Mostly because, and you might not live in the same house, but you probably lived in the same neighborhood or, you know, in the same town, in the same community. You might, if you lived on a farm, you might have brothers and sisters and aunts and uncles all living on that same farm, doing agriculture, doing the same stuff, larger family units. But that started to change as technology started to change. When we found it easy to travel from one location to another at a rapid and inexpensive way, we started seeing sort of the development of what we consider to be the nuclear family, right? And the nuclear family is mom, dad, and then a couple of kids, right? And that's kind of our modern take on the family household, right? Most households are built around the single family occupancy, right? So it's meant to have you know, parents and a couple of kids, and that's how we have been brought up. It wasn't always that way, and again, it's because of technology, right? And how we look at jobs, it also was impacted by education. People started, when they gained access to having a car or access to a train, right? It's always kind of a funny joke when we talk about, say, like the Oregon Trail, right? You know, if you ever played that game, Oregon Trail, almost guaranteed, like 95% of the time you died. Right, you died of dysentery. And part of that is because of the fact that moving from one side of the country to the other side of the country was perilously dangerous because of resources, because of disease, because of violence, right? You might be making that move, but there's a chance you wouldn't survive to get out there. But when we made transportation cheap, effective, and safe, now people can move and chase jobs, right? Maybe you didn't want to be in agriculture. Maybe you didn't want to do what your parents did, and so you want to do something else. Maybe you want an education, so you move to another city to get that education. And it became a lot easier to do so. And in that process, we changed how the family social structure works in this country, and we created our modern nuclear family. So a lot of this had to do with changing times, right? We could now follow individual dreams. We could follow individual ideals, and that became a part of sort of the American dream in and of itself, right? You can accomplish anything. Not we as a family, but you as an individual can follow whatever dream that you have. And we start seeing this practice over and over again, the reality of the individual, right? Instead of focusing on the larger family and the wealth of that family, we start looking at the individual. And that changed resources, that changed generational knowledge, that changed even concepts like adventurousness and security, right? if your money is tied up in the family estate, right? You go out, say you're living with in that Hawaiian structure where you've got 20 people living in the same house, multiple generations. Everyone is depending on your contribution as everyone else is, contributing as well, but you're contributing to everyone. That individualistic sort of ideology doesn't exist there, right? You're mostly focusing on bettering your family and making sure that everything stays the same. So you're not as willing to risk, right? But when we get into sort of these individual families, people, because it's only going to impact you and maybe one or two other people, you're much more willing to risk and to engage in risky behavior. And so we start seeing how different families, different family structures are going to impact the behavior of a culture, right? As a culture, Americans are very easy when it comes to dealing with risk, right? We have very, very, we engage in risky behavior all the time because of the fact that it might only impact you directly. But, right, if you succeed, then your success is definitely yours, right? And all the riches that go with it. If you fail, then that failure is most likely just going to impact you and not necessarily the rest of your family. Right? There's obviously going to be some bleed through that takes place, but that's sort of the general idea. So, understanding how those family structures work can also lead you to understand sort of how individual behavior is going to take place, and ideas of risk, of adventure, of those things are going to be challenged and dealt with. This also changed sort of the ideas around family organization, right? So, as mobility became easier, and families began moving around, they switched from family of orientation to families of procreation. This became more about having more kids instead of having a family sort of ideology, right? So you go out, you find a spouse, you have kids, you procreate, and then those kids leave the house, they go out, find a mate, procreate, right? And it changed again how our economic structure, our social networking and safety nets were adapted, right? You might have grandparents, but your grandparents might live in another state. And grandparents are fundamentally one of the best places for resources, not only because they usually have more, but they have time, right? If they're retired, child rearing becomes a lot easier and cheaper, if they don't mind looking out after the kids. And it leaves that parents' generation to focus more on work and gaining those resources. And if you don't have to worry about your kids and what they're doing and where they're going because they're being dealt with by your family. And aunts and uncles and grandparents and stuff like that. But if you move to a new location and it's just you, right, those resources are not as easy to come by. And this is also kind of changing. We are starting to see more and more people moving back home, having kids. And inviting their parents or grandparents to come stay with them to help economically, especially when we are sort of seeing the economic status of American culture today. Yeah, right. It's hard to buy a house, right? Generational wealth isn't transferring as quick as it used to, And if all you have is your low-income job, right, buying a house becomes nearly impossible. So the idea of having larger families, sharing those resources is becoming more and more popular. We'll do this exercise and then we'll end this segment. And I think this is a really interesting thing. This is pre-COVID, okay? 30% of adults in the United States between 18 and 34 at some point moved home, right? 30%. That's huge. 3 out of 10 people moved home between those age groups. Most of the time, it's because of economic strife, right? Losing a job, not able to make enough money to survive, right? When you've got rents that are $1,500, $2,000 for an apartment, right? It's hard to, make that kind of money and have a lifestyle outside of that. So, a lot of people have been what is sometimes called like boomerang kids. These are folks that leave the house, live outside for a while, come back, live at home, go back out, live an apartment, find a house, come back home, right? Depending on available resources. If we looked at even today, 52% of adults between 19 and 29 are living at home or have lived recently at home. And that is that's huge. That is an absolutely positively massive number. And again, because of especially because of COVID and all of the economic issues that people are facing, younger generations are having a very difficult time maintaining the resources needed for owning a home or even just paying rent. Again, rent is just rent. That money disappears. It actually doesn't add to generational wealth. Buying a home is one of the main ways that people transfer wealth from generation to generation. And this is becoming even more interesting because of the length of how people are surviving, right? Old age is becoming older. People in those generations are surviving into their 80s and 90s. What's happening to their wealth is actually a really interesting subject to talk about because their wealth is being not passed on to the next generation, especially if you have folks that go into like elder care facilities. Those places are not expensive. So the wealth of those older generations are going into these facilities and not being transferred to the following generation. And so that wealth is disappearing, and the following generations don't have that seed money for buying a new house, or for investing. They are having to live off of wages. And so that's changing American economics in a very, very interesting and in some ways scary way, right? So and a lot of that also is indicative of how people deal with their elders, right? Do we want mom and dad living with you when they're having mental issues or bodily issues? Can you take care of them, or do they need to go to a facility? These are serious and interesting questions to consider. Okay, we'll stop there and then we'll continue on with our next segment.